for being here today at our appointment with Hip Hop. My name is Monica Facchini. I'm a professor of Italian and Film and Media Studies. But today I'm here as a representative of 4152, the Challenges of Modernity, to welcome and introduce you our special guests, Danita and Kyle Clark. As an academic, please. As an academic, I usually get to introduce scholars and writers, so I'm especially honored and excited to introduce two great dancers today. It makes me feel kind of cool too. So I'm very happy. The Clarks are among the best 2x2 house dancers in the United States, as they perform in national competitions. They also have represented the U.S. in international competitions, placing in the top 10 in the world. They have served as cultural ambassadors on behalf of the United States, bringing their hip-hop pedagogy to Kazakhstan, Egypt, Israel, and Palestine. At home in Philadelphia, the Clarks run Just Soul Dance and teach hip-hop dance to their community through their own program, Funky Soul Fundamentals, and also through the University of the Arts, Temple University, Drexel University, and William Moore College. We are so lucky to have them today here sharing their talents and passion for teaching. But the Clarks are not performing alone today. They are joined by members of Pocket Hip Hop, Dance Groups, DDT, and Melanated. I also want to say thank you to Kelly Snyder in the 4152 office. This would not be possible without her work. And also a special thanks for coordinating and planning this event to Professor Evolved in Theater. I'm going to leave the floor to the dancers now, so please join me in welcoming the Clarks.
Set up right here really quickly. How you guys doing today? Good? Good. That sound enthusiastic. How you doing today? Good?
Yeah.
Good. We're going 5 hours to be here to speak with you all. So, yeah, let's get enthusiastic.
Hello, everyone. Good afternoon, everybody. Okay.
All right, here we go. Getting started, this hip-hop thing. Welcome to Hip-Hop Histories, okay? Just going to go through a brief timeline of these dances, hip-hop in general. So let's start with the word hip and hop, okay? Let's break down from there and then we'll go, all right? Hip being in the know, or also known as, okay, so how about this? Before we even get into that, let's do some, everybody say call and response.
Call and response.
Call and response.
Call.
All right, it's the oldest learning method known to man, okay? So we're gonna say some things. We're gonna have you repeat a whole bunch of things as we go along, because I'm pretty sure you have 1,500 teachers talking to you all day, and all this information is going in and out, and when you see it through your own body, it's easier for you to file it in your own mental file cabinet. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Cool, all right. All right, everybody say hip.
Yes.
Everybody say hop.
Hop.
Right, hip meaning in the know, or intelligent. Hop meaning club or dancer, okay? So loosely interpreted, intelligent dance or dancer, all right? It's been around now, hip-hop, going on 50 years, yeah? Hip-hop is still very young. Did you know 50 years ago, minorities in this country just got the right to vote? That's how young it is. Does that make sense? Okay, I know that's kind of deep and heavy, but it's the truth, okay? So, hip-hop is a cultural umbrella term. It's so loosely used in so many different ways, it gets very confusing to find out what it is and what it isn't, all right? Especially since it's commercialism going into the late 80s, early 90s. It then shifted some things. But, you know, we had a part to do with that, but we'll get into that, all right? So let's start at 1969, 1970. That's where we're gonna start. That's where we begin earmarking what hip-hop, the dance, and culture actually was, right? Everybody say funk styles.
Funk styles.
So that's where we started. We started with funk styles, okay? So in 1970, a young man by the name of, everybody say Don Campbell.
Don Campbell.
Yes. He was an average teenager, just like some of you all, right? course, you are in your 20s now, but yeah, a teenager. There was a TV show at that time that was coming to downtown LA, right? Everybody say Soul Train.
Soul Train.
Yeah, it was the first of its kind. Every major minority act that ever has done anything major in the world has come through Soul Train. Folks like James Brown, Michael Jackson, you name it, every major entertainer has come from that space. All right, so Don goes to this space. He goes, Bob, I'm gonna be on TV, I'm gonna be famous. So he put on a blue leisure suit. We had the opportunity to meet him in 2007 and 13, I believe, yeah? So talking with Don, he said, you know, hey, I just wanted to have fun, man. I wanted to be seen, I wanted to be known. And televisions at that point were just now becoming everyday household items. It wasn't up until that point, okay? So now that it is, now we all get to see these social dances that are beginning to spurt out of inner city communities being seen and shot live, all right? Cool, so there were two famous dances in 1970. The first one, everybody say Funky Robot.
Funky Robot.
Donnie, can you show them the Funky Robot, please? Hey. Pretty simple, right? It's basically a nice little two-step, right? Okay, and then the other one was,
what was it, Donnie?
All right, everybody say Funky Chicken.
Funky.
Yeah, I know that sounds weird, but that's what it was. All right? So now, you have the Funky Chicken and the Funky Robot, which is equivalent to something like you would see like the Dougie, right? Or the Nene, right? Just social dances. Now, what happens if I tried to do the Nene and the Dougie at the same time? It's going to look strange, right? What's the first thing all of you did? You laughed, right? Now, you do the Funky Robot and the Funky Chicken together? Right. And people at that time laughed at Don the same way y'all just laughed at me. And so what did Don do? He started pointing at him. All right, cool. And from there, people started to catch on. A lot of people laughed at Don in the beginning, like, you're doing it all wrong. And then there were a couple of guys that walked up to him and said, yo, that is funky. We ain't seen that before. I like that. Teach me this. So over time in 1970, he began teaching a few guys, all right? I'm gonna give you their names. Everybody say Scooby-Doo.
Scooby-Doo.
Shaggy-Doo.
Shaggy-Doo.
Flooky-Doo.
Flooky-Doo.
Slim the Robot. Everybody say Rerun. AKA Penguin. Okay? These were some of the guys that he began training, okay? Oh, I'm sorry. And everybody say Greg Camelot Jr. Okay, so these were the guys he was pouring into. And in 1971, they formed a group. Everybody say, The Lockers.
The Lockers.
Yes. They were the very first street dance team to ever dance on television. Everybody say, The Ed Sullivan Show.
The Ed Sullivan
Show. And Soul Train.
Soul Train.
Right, all, these are the first two shows that they performed on. They were also one of the very first groups to go viral. In a sense where they became instant hits. They went all around the country, then all around the globe, teaching locking like this. Their hit was so big, I mean, you know you have to be somebody if you're on Sesame Street. If you're on Sesame Street, then you're somebody. Does that make sense? These are dancers, not actors, not singers, okay, not politicians. They're dancers, and they're on Sesame Street, okay? That's one thing. In 1973, they got the opportunity to perform on Saturday Night Live, okay? And Saturday Night Live is only what, about 42, 43 years old, right? Come again? It's on its 44th season, there you have it. And in 44 seasons, they were the only non-musical act to ever perform on Saturday Night Live in its history. So that shows you that their impact was meteoric. It just hit, kaboom, they started performing in Vegas, all sorts of places, okay? So, there are a couple of moves, okay? So there's the social dance that comes along with any form. No form of dance starts out with just technique. It starts out with social dance and then translates into technique, all right? Over time, it builds like a building, all right? So I'm gonna give you some of the technique that was founded through some of the social dances, okay? So the first step, everybody say muscle man.
Muscle man.
All right, I need a muscle man. Pretty simple, right? Donna said, hey, you know what? We all have to come up with one way that we all do the same thing because they're all teenagers and then they're being asked to perform on live television. They didn't really know what they were doing. They just wanted to have fun, and that's what it was about. So that's how the Muscle Man came about. Next step, everybody say, the lock. That's the step that actually made Dog famous, okay? The lock. It's quick. You can lock in so many different ways. The lock and locking is known as the period. Okay, you have a sentence. You start a sentence, you can start anywhere. Go. Start locking. She's locking. Then she adds her period. Right? So that ends every single phrase that you do. That's how you know you're going to term or the style locking. Okay. Can anybody give me the definition of the word lock? Oh, come on now. We at Colgate University. There's a lot of bright minds in here. So four-letter word. What's the definition of the word lock? I see chin scratch. Okay, go ahead.
Like to secure something?
To secure. Secure has a definition too. Lock. What does secure mean?
Make sure no one takes it.
That's good. Yes.
To hold something in place.
To hold something in place. Very good. That is what the definition of lock means. So the style is about holding in place.
Hold.
Yes, does that make sense? That's why it's called locking. Now you know. If you don't know, now you do. So, without further ado, we're going to have a little demonstration of locking. Come on, guys. Have some of your peers come out here. You know, they put in a lot of work in y'all. So make sure y'all show them some love, yeah?
Hey!
So there it is. Locker, front style, okay? Three things that are necessary for this style. One, everybody say charisma.
Charisma.
Two, everybody say charisma.
Charisma.
Three, everybody say charisma.
Charisma.
Without that, it's a bland style. Does that make sense? Cool. So that's locker. That's downtown LA. What? 1970, okay? That was considered innovative. Where did that come from out of nowhere? Attire had the main with social dances, and he created a brand new trend, okay? Cool, which inspired a lot of technically known as street dancers because they weren't dancing in studios. They didn't have mirrors. They were practicing wherever they could. They didn't even count. They went off sound. You won't groove, but I bop, 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 bop. And I'm gonna go, that's what I'm gonna do, okay? So that's how they counted, all right? So now, we're gonna move on a little bit. We in SoCal, right? LA? Now we're going to NorCal. Everybody say Fresno.
Fresno.
Yeah, Fresno, California. Something was happening there, okay? But once again, it started out with social dance. So around 1975, 76, there were two famous social dancers at that time and point. They were already established far before, but now we're becoming more popular more than ever, all right? So come on right here for me one more time, Danita. Can you show them the baby doll? Right, simple social dance, right? It's fun. Next, can you show them the jerk? That's the real jerk, not the 2K jerk. Okay, cool. Thank you, Danita. There was a gentleman. Everybody say Sam Solomon.
Sam Solomon.
AKA, everybody say Boogaloo Sam.
Boogaloo Sam.
All right, Boogaloo Sam did something different. The same way Don took his social dances and made them something different, Sam took his social dances and did something different. So that same jerk had a double pop. Yeah? He said, what happens if I keep going? And a whole new style began to change and come about. Simple as that. Everybody say evolution.
Evolution.
You've heard of that, right? You know, when something's already there and then it changes into something else. Okay, all right. So there was your evolution. So now you've gone from locking to continuously locking your muscles. The definition of popping is, let's do the Webster's definition right away. Everybody say the consistency of constricting and releasing your muscles. Here's the key part. While dancing. Yeah, a lot of us here popping, right? And the first thing goes, oh yeah, I pop. No releasing of a muscle. Every muscle, including their neck, is tight. Does that make sense? All right? Popping is simple. Matter of fact, let's all learn how to pop. Everybody stand up real quick. Everybody's gonna learn how to pop. Here we go. It's simple. Very, very simple. Good. First, you have to be aware of what it is that you're using. We're just gonna start with our arms, yeah? So I want everybody to pretend that they have an imaginary lat bar above their head, okay? Everybody know what a lat bar is? Some of y'all are like, I never go to the gym. Okay, right? This is no thing that goes like this
and drops right here for you to put your hands on, okay?
So everybody's gonna pull the lat bar down for 8 counts, ready? 5, 6, ready, go.
1, 2, squeeze your muscles really hard, pull it down, pull it down, pull it down, do it again. 4, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, now 4 counts. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. Now you're gonna do it 2 counts, and 1, 2, squeezing your muscles as hard as you can, pulling it. It's 1,000 pounds, you gotta put everything into it. Good.
You feel those arms? You're like, oh, I kind of know how those. Right? Here we go. Now, putting your arms out to the side.
The same squeeze.
Let's make a muscle.
Hold it. Relax. Hold it. Relax. Hold. Relax. Hold. Now, I'm going to go 2 times back to back. Hold. Hold. And go. Hold. Hold. Again, hold, hold. One more time, hold, hold. Arms out, hold, hold. Arms out, hold, hold. Last time, hold, hold. One more, hold, hold.
Congratulations, you know how to pop. That's simple. All right? Now, there are different. Now, when we talk about popping, there are multiple styles that go underneath of the popping umbrella because each style has its own subculture. They are known as their own subcultures, like many planets, right? Okay. So on the planet of popping, there's not just popping, right? There's robot. Now, then there's mannequin. Two totally different things, just so that you know, okay? Then you have waving, right? Then you have ticking or strobing, right? Then you have animation. Okay. Then you have puppet.
Puppet?
Mm-hmm. Okay. So there are multiple different styles that go underneath of the popping umbrella. Oh, by the way, there's no such thing as pop locking. Now you've seen locking, and now you've seen popping. Okay? Cool. So without further ado, with popping, Sam created a group. Everybody say, the Electric Boogaloos.
The Electric Boogaloos.
Uh-huh. They went on Soul Train in 1977. Everybody say 1977.
1977.
That was a big year. Everybody say the hip-hop renaissance.
Hip-hop.
Yeah, a lot of styles got its push to the forefront around 77, right? Cool. Without further ado, let's have our dancers come out here. They're going to demonstrate some popping for you all.
Thank you.
I ain't going after that. I call her the one woman army. Her old nickname is Rock'em Sock'em. It don't matter what style you is, she's gonna give you that work. Know that. Give them some energy, y'all. Give them some energy. It's not easy. It really isn't. It appears easy, but it definitely takes work. The things that are the easiest are the hardest to master. Remember that. You never heard that? You heard it. Quote me. You can actually follow me on Instagram at Just Soul. Quote that, J-U-S-T, Soul of the Foot, S-O-L-E. That's the shameless plug. Moving on. So now, we've done SoCal, we've done NorCal. Now we're gonna cross over to the East Coast. That's where we from. All right? Philly native. I'm a Baltimore native, but actually I'm kind of split. I spent 18 years in Baltimore and 18 years in Philly, so I'm kind of gonna, I got dual citizenship. All right? So, we're going on to b-boying and b-girling. Right? Nobody's b-boying or b-girling today. I just want to put that out there. But we'll show you a couple of things. Here we go. So we're in, everybody say the Bronx. Right, the boogie down. Okay? Wow. There's a rich, rich history there in regards to this style. We call it b-boying or b-girling. We don't like to call it breakdancing in the culture, okay? B-boy or b-girl standing for boogie, Bronx, or break, boy or girl. Okay? In 1973, a guy by the name of, everybody say DJ Cool Herc. One more time. Everybody say DJ Cool Herc. DJ. Hey, man, why is that cool about 52 notes? Because you know you're going to have to test yourself. Stop playing. It's true. Look, it's dying right there. Okay. So, in the Boogie Down, 1973, a gentleman by the name of DJ Cool Herc bought his, he was a DJ. He had these huge speakers. Everybody say the Herculoids. All right. The legend had it was that they were so loud they could crack concrete, okay? I don't know if any of y'all know where the old Deuce and a Quarter is, but it's a very long old Buick. I mean, you know, the really long old Buick. Okay, so he's carrying both of those in the back seat. He has his record player, and he's going to a party. He's throwing a back-to-school jam. This is August 11th, 1973. He's throwing a back-to-school jam for his niece and his cousin, I believe. And so he's like, okay, I'm gonna throw this party. What he did not know was that right before that party in 1973, there were a lot of gangs in New York. You know, like the Warriors, the Black Spades, and things of that nature. There were hundreds of gangs, and they were all in one big war was about to go down at that point. It was over the killing of a gentleman by the name of Black Benji from the Ghetto Brothers. It was a gang, okay, who was innocently killed. He was trying to say, hey, I don't want to do anything. He was killed anyway. So after that, all the gangs rallied up. The sides that believed Black Benji rallied up. The side that killed him rallied up. And they said, okay, it's about to be a mass war in New York. But they finally sat down at the table on behalf of Black Benji's mother and said, hey, I don't want this for my child's legacy. They all agreed. They sat down. They signed the truce. Now, gangs are able to walk into other boroughs in New York and not get killed or maimed. So then, Cool Herc throws his party. And everybody comes. Now, he's a Caribbean native. So, in the Caribbean, what's the weather there? Ha! Right? So they don't play music in the house. Where are they gonna play music at? Outside. So he sets his speakers up, his record player outside in the middle of a burning Bronx, and starts playing his records. Everybody shows up. Everybody's jamming. He's like, whoa, there's hundreds of folks out here. But he noticed that everybody kept going off at one section of the music. Everybody say the breakdown. Does anybody know what happens in the breakdown of music? There's only one instrument that gets highlighted. My man right here, he got all the answers. The drums. Very, very good. Yes, the drums. The drummer takes a solo. Right? So you'll hear something like boom, boom, that right there, the kids started going off. Going what? boom, bah, a doo, boom, bah, boom, 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 bah. All right? He noticed they loved that. So he said, okay, hold on. This is what I'm going to do. I'm going to set one record player here. I'm going to set the other record player here. And now I'm going to play the same part of the song over and over and over and over and over. That's where the B-boys and B-girls began. So that's also why B-boying and B-girling is known as the first official dance of hip-hop, okay? Now, there is a hip-hop style, which we're about to get to in a minute. But here's the thing about B-boying and B-girling. That's not one of the things you can fake. It's actually, B-boying and B-girling is one of the most appropriated dance styles in the world. Hands down. What do I mean? People take the best parts of it and leave the rest of it behind. Like head spins, back spins, windmills. You've seen them more like McDonald's commercials, Gap commercials, all sorts of stuff, right? But you don't see the dance, you just see the trick. And if people think that they do the trick, then they're doing a dance. Not at all. How do I explain it? B-boying and B-girling is like writing a letter. There's an introduction, there's a body, and there's a signature. We all know that, right? The introduction is known as the top rock. Everybody say top rock.
Top rock.
Top rock, you can tell where you're from by your top rock. Period. It's just like you can tell where you are by your dialect. Does that make sense? Right. So if you're in people from Harlem and people from Bronx, they speak different. They use different slang and different terminology. Same way with B-boys. So in New York, has a lot of gestures. They use a lot of gestures with the top rocking. Right? And then you have Philly. Philly has more of a loose style. Everything's loose. Okay, cool. Just to show you the difference in two different styles, all right? So that's the introduction. Hello, dear, to who it may concern, okay? That shows where you're from. Then there's the text. Everybody say text.
Text.
Text is things like the six steps, two steps, three steps, CCs, all that good stuff, okay? I know most of you all don't know what that is. Some of you do. If you don't, Google it. We couldn't do that when we were younger. And if you didn't run into it, you never saw it. Ain't that crazy? Y'all in a beautiful world. Take advantage of it. It's a double-edged sword, though, because now you have to know. You can't say you can be ignorant anymore. That's the crazy part. Sorry. All right? Moving on. So, then you have the signature. Everybody say power moves. All right, the signature. So that's your head spins, back spins, windmills, or whatever. All right? So, imagine somebody writing, Dear John, and then writing their signature for the whole entire paper. Sincerely, my signature. That's what's happening to B-boying and B-girling today. All power moves, and the dance is kind of getting lost. Does that make sense? But that's what happens when you only present the best part of something. People only chase that and leave the originality behind. So I say that in reference when it comes to hip-hop culture. If you have a hip-hop event or there's a party you'd like, pay that $5, pay that $10. Hip-hop can't live without your support. Neither can anything, right? Y'all pay that cable bill so all those cable channels can exist, right? They front the money and then you pay for it by buying your subscription. Hip-hop does the same way. They front themselves and they're like, well, if you pay the $5 or $10 and not ask to get on the guest list, then we can survive. The DJ gets paid, the venue gets paid. Does that make sense? I'm gonna put that out there. All right, so now you know that it's its own culture. It's about the way you wear your hat, your coat, your pants. That's B-boying and B-girling, folks. That came out of the Bronx. We're gonna move on. Everybody say hip-hop social.
Hip-hop social.
All right, so now we've had this fever pitch, right? Look at it like a big U. You have social dance on this end, you have technique on this end, right? Things start out as a social dance, they go all the way back to the technique. Then from the technique, there's only one other way to go. Back down to the social dance. Alright? So we started out with locking, popping, and b-boying and b-girling. We can pretty say those are pretty technical, sufficient styles. Now we go back to social dance, because now the music has changed. So in the late 80s, b-boy died out. Right? B-boying and b-girling died out. But funk music, something began to happen. Everybody, well, one significant thing happened. Does anybody know what an 8-track is? Exactly. An 8-track used to be a cassette tape the size of a VHS tape. Right, and people had them in their cars. Imagine having a bag of VHS tapes like this to play your favorite song in a car. That's what it used to be. Then there came this invention. Everybody said a cassette tape. Oh, that changed everything. Now you can dub anywhere, anytime. Your load went from a 100-pound bag to a 10-pound bag. Now you can travel anywhere, anytime, carry your favorite songs with you. You can record off the radio, and you can also, everybody say sample. You can sample music now. So now that sampling music has become easier, you have the children of funk now sampling those same funk records they heard in their house and doing rap over them. Everybody say hip-hop music. Hip-hop music had its birth, okay? It sampled funk music with rap over it. That's it. They changed the speed to change the key so that it's not copyright infringement, and then they rap, okay? That changed the game. So now the speed isn't as fast as some James Brown tracks. Now it's slowing down a little bit. And now we get into social dances like the crisscross. Oh, come on out here, Donita. Hip-hop social dances. These are the dances that crop out of every neighborhood. That's what hip-hop, the dance style is. Okay? So things like Chicken Pursuit. Coming out of Harlem, right? We got Dougie. How about the Wu-Tang coming out of Philly? All right. Let's start at St. Louis Shake. Yeah. Oh, see, I got into this. All right. So these are some of the social dances that have cropped up. That's what makes hip hop social dance. Now, to equate it, this is how we know that it connects with its African ancestry, because you don't have to choreograph it. It choreographs itself. So all you got to do is put 10 social dances together and you have hip hop choreography. But see now, I know you all are asking, well, what is things like America's Best Dance Crew? So you're thinking of dance. All right, let's get right to this real quick. Commercialism. Remember that appropriation thing we talked about? We take the best part of something and then we get it. Okay. So you had a whole bunch of hip-hop artists coming out. All right, so let's start with 1988, okay? 1988, Steps on Broadway. Does anybody know what that is? No, Steps on Broadway is one of the biggest dance studios in downtown Manhattan, okay? In 1988, a man by the name of, everybody say Buddha Stretch.
Buddha Stretch.
Was the very first studio hip-hop dance teacher, okay? There, in 1988, all right? So, hip-hop was now becoming mainstream, the dance. It's coming off the street and going in. The very first hip-hop dance crew, everybody say Mata. Uh-huh, coming right out of NYC, okay? Cats from different boroughs got together, and they were taking some of those funk elements and putting them into the new social dances that were going on, kind of sort of like rappers were taking funk samples of music and then making their own thing, right? So now you have a hip-hop crew, because before, all crews were b-boy crews. Why? Because there were b-boy crews were converted gang crews. And so why they did their dance was to avert themselves from striking each other. Now you have hip hop just being done for the love of the music. No more for trying to battle people. Now it's just about dancing, okay? So you have, everybody say Elite Force Crew.
Elite Force.
Which is one half of Mop Top. We'll get to the other half of Mop Top in a minute. So Buddha Stretch is the leader of Elite Force Crew. He's choreographed for everybody from Michael Jackson, Mariah Carey, Aaliyah, you name it. Will Smith, oh my God, he did all the Will Smith videos, he did the Men in Black videos. He's done so much, okay? Okay, him and his crew. TLC, how did I forget that? All right, so, how do I put this? They're hired to do a video shoot. They say, okay, Buddha Stretch, we want you to choreograph this video. Okay. Well, I got my friends over here, but we're not asking for your friends. We have this group of dancers right here. Yeah, you know, the ones with the headshots and the resumes. They're ready. They're ready right now. We need you to do this right now. And you only have 20 minutes. Okay. You look around, you see ballet, modern, and jazz dancers, and you're like, okay, well, we're going to start here. One, two, three, and they're looking at him like, And he realized after a couple minutes, they were not going to get it right now. And they're under the gun. It's a lot of pressure. You can feel it in the room, right? Because it's your first big shot. So he says, okay, how about this? We just want to choreograph to the words so you don't have to worry about the beat. Okay, that's how that commercial dance style music video style started. Because they were just trying to make sure that something happened. Video after video after video after video. Buddha Stretch's biggest video. Everybody say 1993.
1993.
Everybody say,
remember the time.
Michael Jackson, okay? He's on the video, Nick is on the video, Bruce Joint is on the video. They're all a part of Elite Force Group, all right? So steps like this now have become famous. All right, this right here is known as the Bart Simpson slide. Why? Because Stretch was like, yo, I remember Bart Simpson used to act like a Batman. He would call himself Bartman, right? And go like this. That's where that dance came from. It inspired him to do this. And then you wonder, you take steps like this, and then you do this. That's evolution, you understand? It evolves like that, okay? So now, you have hip-hop hitting the mainstream in every single music video. But, people are dancing to the words now, and not dancing to the beat. Which now creates a different trend. And then when they go and dance on tour for people like Michael Jackson and Janet Jackson, things change, because Michael was trained by the Electric Boogaloos. Two of them. Everybody say Pop and Pete. Who was? Boogaloo Sam's younger brother. And then you have everybody say Popping Taco.
Popping Taco.
Which was a cousin of theirs. Okay? So they're training Michael Jackson. Michael Jackson is the king of what? One more time. Oh! But he's going, he's ticking. He's tutting. In the Remember the Time video, right? So now Michael Jackson is synonymous with hip hop. That's where it changes. Do you understand? Cool. So now people think the commercial style is hip-hop because it's on television being presented that way, but the authentic dance is still underground and nobody's going underground to find it. They're just taking what's being offered above. Okay? So that's where that split between commercialism and authenticity happened. But all of these guys are still alive, well, and kicking it. All of them are 50. One of them just won a hip-hop battle. One just won a house battle. They're still battling people at 50. So, with that being said, I'm going to bring you into hip-hop, hip-hop, hip-hop. Without further ado, groups, are you ready? All right, they're going to do some hip-hop for y'all. Now, hip-hop has transformed in so many different ways now. We wanted to present a piece that was going to take us back to the beginning of the roots of hip-hop, which was about consciousness. It was about bringing light to not only the negativity, but what we have to do to resolve issues. Yeah, but that can't happen unless we point it out. So this is what this piece is about.
Yes, y'all.
parties. She didn't have a body, but she started it in there. Did a couple of videos of it, and I could send you. Out goes the weed, in goes the brave bees medallions. She was on that tip about stopping the violence. About my people, she was teaching me. Not preaching to me, but speaking to me. In a method that was leisurely, so easily I approach. She dug my rap, that's how we got close. But then she broke to the West Coast, and that was cool. Around the same time, I went away to school, and I'm a man that expanded. So why should I stand in her way? She probably get her money in LA, and she did stuff. She got big bubble, what was five? She said that the whole block was going out of style. She said Afrocentricity was of the past. But she got in the R&B and house, bass and jazz. Now black music is black music, and it's all good. I wasn't sorry she was with the boys in the hood. Cause I was too far, she was becoming well-rounded. I thought it was dope, but she was on that freestyle. Cause I didn't know. Now worried about everyone, you can tell. Yes, yes, y'all. Don't stop. It's in the beat, y'all. Don't stop. Yes, yes, y'all. Don't stop. One, two, y'all. Don't stop. Yes, yes, y'all. Don't stop. Until the beat, now I gotta be sure stop. Yes, yes, y'all. Don't stop. Yep, get on, check. I might have felt a hitcher that this chick was creative. Plus the man got you when you're on to the lady. Told her if she got an energetic gimmick, then she can make money. And she did it like a dummy. Now I see her in commercials. She's universal. She used to only speak it with the inner city circle. Now she be in the birds with the rock and dress and quick. And on some dummy when she comes to the city. Talking about popping rocks, serving rocks and hitting the switches. Now she's a gangster rolling with gangster. Always smoking, getting drunk, telling me sad stories. Stretching out her forward wrist. She was really gorilla before she got in the show. But I did it, not just to say I did it, but I'm committed. So if many of you did it, that she's just not the same. That dog is moving through her. I see you get better and take it to the sewer. But I'ma take her back home and that is not. Cause who I'm talking about, y'all, is hip-hop. It's just a beat, y'all, if you don't stop. Yes, yes, y'all. Don't stop, man, Frank, only gotta be the short shot. But yes, yes, y'all, don't stop. It's in the beat, y'all, don't stop. But yes, yes, y'all, if you don't stop. But one, two, Compsis is gonna drop.
Good afternoon, y'all. All right, so the future song there was Basic Hip Hop Social Dances. Perfect, right? In a straight line. You go back 10,000 years. In Africa, you'll see two or three drummers. So folks, possibly in a circle with hots or not, yes? And then somebody doing a social dance native to their tribe, for whatever reason, right? You move forward 10,000 years, you go to the club, what do you see? Two or three DJs, people on the outside, like, yeah! And then somebody, like Dave Tell Stark, doing a social dance native to their city, yes? There's nothing has changed but the day, the time. That's it, okay? That just shows you how music and dance is universal, all right? Moving on, last time, going back to 1977. Everybody say 1977.
1977.
All right, here we go. Everybody say DJ Frankie Knuckles.
DJ Frankie Knuckles.
Uh-huh, was asked to do something major. He said, I want you to be a headliner of this brand new club. Everybody say Downtown Chicago. Yeah. Everybody say Club Warehouse.
Club Warehouse.
He was now the new resident DJ of this club called Club Warehouse. And it blew up. Every A-lister from around the globe came to Chicago to hear this sound. It was revolutionary. Frankie Knuckles had taken R&B music of the 70s, which was, I just played it for you. R&B of the 70s. What music were we dancing to when we were in the 70s section? Everybody say funk? Oh, well, yes. Funk was on the radio in the 70s. It wasn't trap. Okay? All right, so we got funk. He took funk records and was adding in electronic sounds and Afro drum and bass beats. Change the culture of music. All right? Now, between 1977 and 83 is when this club was opened. And when it shut down in 83, most of the music in the movement moved back to New York, all right? All right, so, when it moved to New York, it resided in, at the time, two major gay clubs in New York, all right? Everybody say Paradise Garage and The Loft, all right? Those were two major clubs that were playing only house music, all right? So you remember those hip-hop dancers I was telling you about, Mop Top? Okay, well, Mop Top then, you know, began to be a little less active. Yes, they were traveling the globe for hip-hop, but they weren't doing much at home at the time. And because most of the clubs were being shut down in the late 80s, early 90s, due to hip-hop's labeling as dangerous. And now I did a little research lately, and I realized just about, 2 years ago, the cabaret law here changed? And when I read about that, I said, wow, how long has that cabaret law been enacted? Meaning that nobody can dance in a bar setting, yeah, without a license. It's crazy. And that went all the way back to the 1920s. We're talking about prohibition, okay? That just got changed in 2017. Hello. So people couldn't dance in bar areas without a license. That's crazy. So when you think about it that way, they used that to shut down hip-hop clubs. They didn't have a license, they got shut down, okay? And now because of that, these hip-hop dancers have nowhere to go. But a young special lady at the time, who was a part of that Mob Top crew and hip-hop movement at the time, everybody say Marjorie Smart.
Marjorie Smart.
God bless her soul, she passed, going on 5 years ago now, okay? She was only 46, she was very young, she died of breast cancer, okay? But at that time, she began going to the Paradise Garage in the Loft, which was playing house music, not hip-hop, okay? She had a blast. She said, you know what? This is like the most amazing thing I've ever experienced. And she went to every borough, knocking on all of her crew members' doors, like, yo, y'all need to come out with me to the club. They're like, the gay club? They're like, yes, I'm telling you, that's where the music is. They're like, oh, no, man, because back then the stigma was different than it is today. You understand? It wasn't cool to be either a minority or a gay. And you want us to be both in the same spot? Like, it was scary for them, all right? But nonetheless, they took the risk, they went out, they began learning. And lo and behold, they had the time of their life. And house and hip hop went like this. Okay, cool. So, now, I mean, they fell so in love that Mop Top split into two. One half, Elite Force. The other half, everybody say Dance Fusion.
Dance Fusion.
Mm-hmm. Which is the pioneering house crew, which Donita and I belong to, DFF, Dance Fusion family, all right? Which is an honor and privilege. These guys took those social dances that they learned in the house club and then took them and pioneered them around the world, all right? So there are a couple of steps I want to show you, all right? So house dance is comprised, we call it a fusion form, of four different styles. Everybody say African? Because all of these styles are African diaspora because they're all a 4-1-time signature, okay? Next, everybody say Latin.
Latin.
Then you have tap.
Tap.
And hip-hop social dance.
And hip-hop social dance.
All rolled into a ball, which created this space because hip-hop is pedestrian. That's why anybody from any walk of life can come in and learn it. We all walk heel to toe, don't we? All right. There are all ages and races on the stage right now dancing, right? Right, okay? Hip-hop is inclusive in that way. Right? Cool. So, some of the basic foundational steps that come in with house. Starting out with the jack. Jack your body, right? You hear songs like, jack, jack, jack your body, Then you have the extended jack, what we call big jacks. Boom, we're extending it from the floor. We have a step called the chase, which then turns into a step called the loose leg, where you wiggle the legs as you go. You have steps like the Dodger, sidewalks, okay, sweeps, alright, and our favorite, pas de bourrée. Okay, cool. So these are some of the dances that go along with house dance, and this is our last demonstration. Give it up for our group. Come on, boys, here we go.
went to a war, gathered his name, he is a monster. Matthew 18:20, has things, cannot be a witness, cannot be a witness. Thank you.
I learned about 15 minutes of choreography and like 3 rehearsals. It's crazy. All right, so one more time, give it up for them. It's not easy. It's not. Next, give it up for the Queen King, I need you all. Hip hop culture is still young, it's still here. Everybody is still invited. Just make sure that you put something in the pot. That's all. You gonna eat the bread for praise. You gonna drink the milk, throw a dollar in the pot. Does that make sense? That's what hip hop is all about. It's a space because it comes out of, you know, marginalized and oppressed places. A lot of folks, let's say from Africa, for instance. I was just in Nigeria about 3 months ago. And the beautiful thing about it was that they all had so much pride in what tribe they were from, where their origins are, what their group is. And then I realized, wow, hip hop was our culture. That's what we were born into. We didn't have a specific African space to say that we were from. Hip hop was where we were from. That's why it's so personal for a lot of people. Does that make sense? And what hip hop did is before they even realized what they had, they opened the door and invited everybody in. But then other folks tried to lock them out. Does that make sense? So at the end of the day, the best way to help promote a healthy culture is just to participate, not appropriate. Does anybody have any questions before we go? No question is a stupid one. We are all here to learn because not knowing only leads to knowing. Yes. Yes. Well, because breakdancing was the media term it was given. Even though, yes, they are dancing to the break, they prefer to be called B-boys and B-girls. That's just how they are. It's the culture, yeah?
What are you guys' favorite hip-hop styles?
House. We fell in love with it. We both started out with Latin. You started out with house.
Yeah,
we were both
trained.
Okay, yeah, so most of us, we started out with Lockie. We were trained by a man by the name of Montel Durden, who now is the associate professor for the very first hip-hop dance major at USC. So he trained us in locking, and then one day he started loose-legging, and we were like, what is that? He said, oh, it's house. I said, you gonna teach me that? He said, we don't teach that. He said, I don't teach that. You know, it's a personal thing for me. But, well, I'll take y'all to the club. Y'all wanna go to the club? Yeah! And that's how we learned, yeah? So it was kind of sort of like that. Any other questions? No question is a stupid one. Shoot. Yes. For ourselves personally, going on 17 years now. Okay. Come again? Yeah, well, I mean.
Well, we perfected it a lot sooner than
that. But you know, everything takes time. We understand, and you know, people tend to get bored with the styles and quit or go to other styles because they feel like they get bored with it, but there's no way to be bored with foundation. You can look at it like English. How many times have we spoken or written, but we find new ways to write and think about things? Does that make sense? So it can never get old. But yes, 17 years in total over time, but I say about 7 or 8 to get them so ingrained in the body we're not thinking about them. Yeah? Any other questions? Shoot. Ignorance is not bliss today. It is not, because the less you know, the more mistakes you make. Ask questions. Yes?
From my hometown.
From the hometown.
My hometown is the Wu-Tang, but that's not my favorite style of dance. Yeah, the music is cool, but I'm more so driven by house music because of the spiritual connection to the lyrics, and the music just takes me to a different place. So that's my favorite style overall, especially because, well, for both of us, you know, it's such a fusion form, as we said, of African, Latin, tap, and hip-hop social. And then there's also other elements that you can add within it when you're in the club. And in club dance, everything goes. When you get into battles, it becomes something else. Yeah, they're looking for specific foundational moves and technique, of course, because that's the language that you're speaking, so you have to demonstrate that. But house is not as restrictive to my soul, if that makes sense. Yeah, because it's driven by the music that takes me to another plane. And that's what I love about it.
For my hometown, it was a SpongeBob. This is where y'all did in the club. There was no real, like, social dance in Baltimore at the time outside of the SpongeBob. And there were some elements of something like the Wu-Tang, which was like this movement right here, but that's only one part of the Wu-Tang. But that's what we did in Baltimore. So that's all I saw folks doing with that and the SpongeBob, because I was, you know, sneaking in the club. I shouldn't have been there at 16, but hey, you know, we all wanted to know, okay? Cool. Any other questions? No questions, a stupid one. Yes. When it comes to, you can tell the difference between somebody trying to be a motivational speaker and somebody just talking to you. You can distinguish that difference, right? Right, it's the same way. We can feel when somebody's in the spirit of in music, and we can feel when somebody's on top of it. So when they're on top of it, their beak striking, right? That boom, bat, bat, bat. That's beat striking. And then there's dancing, where you add in tone color and tone pressure. Yeah, those two things create sensation, the feeling you get from music. Like when a singer hits a certain key in a certain pitch at the right time, then all of a sudden what happens?
Chill
bumps, right? So that's how we kind of sort of differentiate. It's hard for the untrained eye, but folks that are in dance know the difference. Yeah, you just know. And you'll feel it. You'll feel it for yourself. And you're like, yo, I really dig that. Yeah? Cool. Yes?
Do you have a favorite song or artist?
Oh, wow. That's a tough one. Because there's so many genres of music. Woo! I'm a funk head first, house head second, hip hop third. I mean, my favorite hip hop artist is Jay-Z. I have to say that. Who is your favorite hip hop artist?
I'm feeling Common right now.
You feeling Common?
Yeah.
Okay. Mine was James Brown for funk.
Of course, James Brown.
You can't lose with that. You got funk, you got hip hop. I mean, popping George Clinton, my goodness. That electronic sound, he was the pioneer of that. So, you know, it's, and Bootsy Collins, there were a lot of guys that are really good. It's hard to just say that one group. But for house, oh, DJ Charisma. It's a lot of people making music.
Yeah.
It's hard to have one favorite. Yeah? Any other questions? Yes!
Do you know what it's like being a woman in hip-hop?
Boom!
Whoa!
Waiting for that one.
Woo! All right. Yeah, so being a woman and a two-time mother, yeah, with a prince and a princess, thus made me the queen. Yeah?
Thank you.
Yeah, so, I mean, growing up, when I couldn't find authentic hip-hop and street dance classes. They either told me to take ballet, modern, and I was lucky to even have African. But when it came to hip-hop, it was just like I was only exposed to what I saw on videos. So when I looked at the videos, I'm like, I don't want to have on a sports bra and booty shorts and do like this. Like, can I be challenged? I want to grow somewhere. When I was introduced to Lock-In, we met Montel first. It opened up my eyes to different movies. I saw, like, what's the name of that movie? Breaking. And the girl was like bragging, and then they were locking and popping. And I was like, I'm gonna find that here. And they didn't have that accessible in Philadelphia. So I was a little frustrated with that. But then going to University of the Arts, in which we had Montel for like one semester, and that was that, because they did a hip hop class that was called Styles of Jazz, and it was personal choreography. And I'm like, I don't wanna learn your personal gestures. I'm gonna learn some foundation. I wanted to like this. So when I had the opportunity to actually learn those different styles, I took it very seriously. We danced for Rennie Harris Crew Movement as principal dancers. So we were allotted opportunities to teach workshops. And if I'm going to teach a workshop, I'm going to know what I'm teaching and what I'm talking about. Also growing up, you know, it wasn't cool to be a biter. Yeah, somebody that rips your moves, I can't do what Kyle is doing. That would make me a biter, right? So I wanted to be original. When I learned the foundation and technique and take that somewhere else. So I really didn't want to teach anybody, because I don't want to teach you to be me until I understand who I am and then understand the foundation and technique, then I can teach you, right? So I really honed all these styles, and I just wanted to be the best artist that I could be. And then
Then as I got good, people were just like, oh man, she's good for a female, or you're the best female here. No, I'm gonna transcend female. Either I'm good or I'm whack. Either I'm great or I'm corny. Like, let me define myself through my artistry, not as being a woman, so to speak. So, even saying that I'm a hip hop dancer, people would even look at me, size me up, see my locks, look at my body and think, oh, she's just going to booty shake. Yeah, so I've been defining myself as a, as an artist, as a female artist, as a woman. And I take that seriously. Yes, I am a woman and I embrace that, but I want to be known for my artistry because I am an artist first. Understood? So, yeah, just like being judged when I walk in the room about what I'm going to do opposed to what I'm actually doing after they see me dance has been a surprising thing for a lot of people. Yeah, because they judge you on being a woman and having a body, which I'm proud of. But just saying, respect me for my art. So, women has been getting a lot of positive feedback. For instance, I'm going to be a part of Ladies of Hip Hop. I'm going to be on the judge panel, judging the house dances category, which I'm very proud of, representing for women from ages young and old. If you're a woman and you're a dancer, just get down and do what you want to do. But I'm really proud to have a platform in which I can motivate other females and women to be the best artists and women that they can be and have pride within that. There's nothing wrong with booty shaking, but you can learn more and you can definitely be respected for your art. If that answers anything or everything, yeah? Thank you very much.
Any other questions? Get them now while they're here. Not sure how often, you know, folks come doing hip hop dance at a Colgate.
Okay, so you have the foundation. I think I speak loud enough.
Okay.
Oh, no, go ahead. You were going
to?
Go ahead.
How do you add? That was a very difficult question for myself because, you know, people are very hard on culture vultures, people that come into a culture and just do the dance, and then some people who have never even seen a club or a battle end up teaching in collegiate settings. So that's something that I really was careful of. So I didn't teach my first 7 years because I wanted to also answer that question, which was, how do I add? How do you add is by participating and not appropriating. As in, you know, okay, I'm a house dancer now, but in order to be considered that, you had to be in place where house living. So up until this day, I've been in a club probably every weekend, not recently in the last 2 years after having children, but up until that point, 13 years, almost in perfect attendance in the club. You understand? Like, every Saturday, Sunday, when we first started, we had 4 club nights a week. And then they slowly dwindled every 2 or 3 years. Now it's down to like 1 or 2 parties a week. But we go to all of those. And once you go and participate long enough, you'll know when you're a part of the culture or when you're innovating it. And what we realized was that our gift went beyond just dancing in the club.
Yeah.
And when it came to choreography in a theatrical setting, dancing with Brittany Harris, it kind of was the inspiration there where it was just like, oh wow, this does have value. So how do I innovate it? Not doing it like him, finding my own way to present art from my experience. So when you bring your experience into the culture and use your experience as a mirror of the culture, that's how you add to it, yeah? But you have to participate first. Because I mean, just because you can speak a language doesn't make you from that culture, i.e. if you took French for 2 years, that doesn't make you a Frenchman. You would have to go to France, live for a couple of years, then you say, you know what, I want to add to French culture. Well, I know French culture says this. Well, I've never seen anybody in French culture do this. Let me do that. Some people gonna laugh, some people gonna flock, and some people might say, oh, that's kind of cool, what is that? And that's how it picked up, just like Darn, just like Sam, just like the B-Boys, Rock Steady Crew, just like House Dancers, and B-Boys, they all did the same thing. They just participated. And then innovation happened to fall on its own. Yeah? Cool. We good? Yes, one more. Well, our activism is the consistent, is basically, our social activism is continuing to practice black art. Because black aesthetic is valued more than black art. Some people just want to buy something that looks black. They don't want to purchase the black art, i.e. they They want dancers to look like hip-hop, but not do hip-hop dance. So our social activism, our body is basically a protest. Our dance is a protest to the norm of commercialism and appropriation. So by continuously doing that, that creates our social activism. And then we have an educational company called Funky Soul Fundamentals, which is dedicated to the preservation of those things. So what we do is we bring all of those pioneers and OGs who started hip-hop, and we bring them to Philadelphia and have them teach for very low rates. Like, I'm talking $15 a class, but when they go to Europe, they're charging like $200 a class. So we only charge $15 a class for people. Euro, right, not even USD, we're talking Euro, okay? So we only charge them $15, and that's our way of having our outreach slash community activism. You know, we'll have it consistently. So it doesn't get lost, you know, because it'll get washed away very easily if people don't practice or show the best aspects of it. Because a lot of misnomers are put out there based upon, you know, things like you see crumping and people, you know, call it negative or it looks very aggressive or violent. But I mean, if you grew up, if you were 9 years old in the LA riots in 1992 and you saw those white officers get off, what would your dance look like? Frustrated, right? Right. So that's our social. Yes, that's a great question, by the way. Thank you for that. Yes? Any other questions? No? Well, thank you very much. My name is Tyler Clark. This is Daddy and Clark. Thank you, BBT and Melody. You guys are amazing. You can find us on Instagram at JustSoul, Oh. You can find our company, Just Soul Street Dance Theater, at Just Soul SDT. You can find Donita at Queen_Donita, D-I-N-I-T-A. Follow us. We'll be back next semester, okay? We'll try to do something else for you all, yeah? Cool, take it easy.